Another year, another strategy review. But as the White House releases its third report on the war in Afghanistan, political realities have shifted. Special Representative for Afghanistan and Pakistan Richard Holbrooke is dead. And so is the State Department's cherished secrecy. As much as the president may want to come out and say that progress is being made, anyone who's read those WikiLeaks cables knows that even as he's done that before, local officials have been reporting quite the opposite. Without success or secrecy, and without the Teflon of Ambassador Holbrooke, what happens next? In a moment, Rick Rowley, independent journalist with Big Noise Films. But first this.
As General Petraeus mentioned, 1 year ago, I ordered additional troops to serve in this country that was the staging ground for the 9/11 attacks. All of those troops are now in place. And thanks to your service, we are making important progress. You are protecting your country. You're achieving your objectives. You will succeed in your mission.
Rick Rowley, the president was saying that as people were reading the WikiLeaks cables, among others from, well, Ann Patterson, the U.S. ambassador in Pakistan, saying progress is not being made, quite the opposite. Has something shifted when it comes to the president's ability to tell anything people will accept as anything close to truth?
Well, I mean, I think the amazing thing is, based on what has been leaked and what has been said publicly about what's going to be in these reports coming out, and it's not just one, there's two intelligence reports and the Defense Department's own report, is that they are both, in spite of whatever small cosmetic differences they have, going to continue on the same delusional line that has been pushed by the president and by the military for years. I mean, in that same speech, President Obama said there are places in Afghanistan that were under Taliban control before that are no longer under their control. That statement is technically true, but it is vastly misleading. It is also true to say that there are many, many times more places in Afghanistan that were under government control last year that are now under Taliban control. I mean, the fact is, the simple ground truth is that NATO is losing the war in Afghanistan in every quantifiable way.
So, but you talked about it as delusional. Who's being deluded? Are people still being deluded? We've looked at those cables, at least some of us, haven't we?
I mean, that is a question for American public opinion. I mean, what's clear from those cables is that the State Department, is that the government itself is not as deluded as it would, doesn't believe even the sort of the lies and the half-truths that they peddle.
And what about the significance of the passing of Richard Holbrooke? Here's just one report on his death. Take a look.
Now to the death of America's top diplomat in Afghanistan and the architect of much of our policy there. We were very sad to learn that Richard Holbrooke had died last night in Washington after undergoing emergency heart surgery. And according to a U.S. official, his last words to his Pakistani surgeon were, quote, "You've got to stop this war in Afghanistan."
Well, there you have it. Sober, dedicated to the end, committed to the end of the war in Pakistan and Afghanistan, even with his last words. What do you make of that type of presentation of Richard Holbrooke?
Well, I mean, he has been a hawk among diplomats since the very beginning. I mean, he pushed an incredibly severe sanctions regime against the Iraqi people that killed maybe 500,000 Iraqi children. He was a strong proponent of the invasion of Iraq and the war against Iraq. I mean, he is sort of symbolizes for most people the sharp end of America's diplomatic stick, the use of war as diplomacy as an extension of war rather than war as an extension of diplomacy.
So does his absence from this picture now change the options for the president?
You know, I actually don't think so. I think it was a mess before, it's a mess after. I mean, if anything could be said to be worse or more of a failure than America's military campaign on the ground, it is the diplomatic campaign that accompanied it. I mean, not only are we seeing, a Taliban insurgency that is spreading across the country, growing stronger every year, that has the momentum, not the U.S., but we're seeing before our eyes the Afghan state continue to just disintegrate. I mean, that it was the main sort of pillar of the diplomatic effort there, and it's a total failure. The other thing that was talked about a lot was the negotiations with the Taliban that we learned were half a psychological operation, that were a lie being told both to the American people and to Afghans to convince them that something was happening, and the other half was some random Afghan civilian passing himself off as a high-ranking Taliban member being paid hundreds of thousands of dollars by the Americans to sit in negotiations that were totally meaningless. So every aspect of this the war there is a disaster, and anyone whose career has passed through there has been sullied by it.
Now we're going to talk about the right, and we've been talking about Republicans all week, talking about money and taxes and deficits and you name it. The WikiLeaks cables reveal, among other things, you know, where some of the money has gone that was supposed to be going to build up the Afghan state. The former vice president being found arriving in Abu Dhabi with $52 million in a suitcase in cash. Is anyone raising hell about this in Washington?
I mean, the scale of the fraud, it's almost industrial in Afghanistan. I mean, I remember one of the leaks, people were complaining about the Iranians bribing officials there. I mean, the Iranians may spend a few million here and there, but the Afghans have to palletize the loads of cash that they get from the Americans. I mean, it's truly astronomical. No money is actually getting onto the ground, into programs and aid and redevelopment at all.
On the ground, killing continues. We in the U.S. only really hear about the Americans, but the American death count week by week is pretty chilling. Here's just the most recent example from ABC.
We remember all of those who died in war this week, and the Pentagon released the names of 12 soldiers and Marines killed in Iraq and Afghanistan.
Looking for footage of Afghan civilian deaths or Afghan victims, period. And that's much harder to find. We found some. But as this strategic review, and you mentioned all of them, come out, where is the press on covering what's actually happening to actual people on the ground?
I mean, there is very little, but there has been very little of it since the beginning of the war. It continues to be a shame for the American media establishment that it doesn't cover the real impact of the war. I mean, wars are not really about soldiers anymore. I mean, soldiers are die in these wars, and that's tragic, but the real casualties and the real victims of wars are civilians. I mean, massively more Afghan civilians are dying, and those numbers are increasing. And you're right, I mean, there's very little coverage of it. I mean, we just came back from a trip in October where we were documenting some of the victims of U.S. night raids. You've seen over the summer, since I think basically after the counterinsurgency campaign in Marja stalled and Helmand Province stalled, a transition away from what they called population-centric counterinsurgency, where they supposedly were very careful about trying to kill civilians. Petraeus has brought back airstrikes on a large scale, and they've massively ramped up these special forces raids where they're killing thousands of Afghans every couple of months. Just to give you an example of one of the raids, we went to a raid in Paktia province in Gardez. It's one of the few of these thousands of raids that actually got any sort of media coverage, because the American Special Forces team went in, they killed two pregnant women, a 16-year-old girl, the head policeman for Gardez, and the lead prosecutor. Then they dug the bullets out of the women's bodies with knives, bound them, claimed to the press that it was that they had stumbled upon a Taliban honor killing, and then covered it up and it ran with that story for months after the facts were sort of slowly leaking out, and they were only finally months later forced to admit that they had killed the wrong people.
Do we need a WikiLeaks for the pictures?
Absolutely. I mean, it would be amazing to get a hold of the U.S. military's own documentation of these raids. They film them all, and they have those archives somewhere. But to be able to see, actually, the places where where this war is actually being fought, in secluded rural compounds where the press can't go, and where we can only rely on two sentence blurbs in NATO press releases that say two Taliban insurgents were killed, no civilians were injured.
Rick Rowley, if people want to see some of your footage, where can they go, or can they?
Yeah, bignoisefilms.org. We have many of our reports. Most of the pieces that we do are aired on Al Jazeera English.
All right, we'll have links to Big Noise at our website.